Okay, Psalm 13.5 small minutes since the clock 7 in Uyo, Akwa Ibom State, Nigeria. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the second part of 30 Days of Glory, happening live from the international headquarters of Power City International. My name is Michael Bush. I'm so excited you're here. I have great news for you. First, though, let me welcome Papa, the man who makes all the things happen, the man that God is using mightily. Dr. Abel Damina.
Mr. Bush, so good Papa, to have you again nice to and return. To be with you today.
So nice to be here with you, Papa.
Praise God.
So I'm super excited. I don't know. Where's the director? You're not showing Papa, you're showing just me. Okay. Let's just get down for our radio audience, in case you didn't grab the offering details. I hope that some of you already have the offering details, some of the bank details that you need to do your offering, because, I mean, when you hear the word of the Lord, you need to do your offering. Power City International, that's the account name. FCMB is 29828020. Zenith Bank is 101-2365-912. And then UBA is 100-3926-465. Because of time or the lack of it tonight, I'm not going to be repeating any message. Okay. I have some great news. Okay, before I break the other one is really the greatest news. But the week one quiz winner is known now. And I'd like to thank such a one. The question, remember, was the transgression of sin. Is it of Moses, true or false? And someone in Lagos, Nigeria, scored all of 7/10, according to my producer. So the transgression of sin, is it of Moses because he gave the law, true or false? And he goes on to say the answer is false. And he went on to explain that the Bible makes us understand that sin was already in the world even before Moses was born or gave the law of sin below. And he mentioned Romans 5:12, King James Version, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And he concluded today, if any man believes in the finished work of Christ, on his behalf is born again and is free from sin and the cause of the law. Glory to God. His name is Kesena Efere. Kesena Efere is in Lagos, Nigeria. We're going to be sending you an email, and there is a pastor of Power City International right there on the ground in Lagos. He'll be talking with you shortly. So thank you and congratulations, Kesena Efere. So in that same spirit, with two quiz, the question is, the law is not of faith. What is? The law is not of faith. What is? Quickly send your answers to 30daysofglory@gmail.com. And remember, we'll be coming here now next Saturday to give you the winner, to announce the winner. Okay, some big things are happening. Real big, big, big things. Just as we got off the program last night, the studio brought an email from the United States of America, where some Yoruba, I don't know what is, pastor, had taken time to translate the message of Papa into Yoruba. My God, you could actually see it. I'll allow you to see that in a moment.
Yeah.
But just as I came here today preparing for this second stanza, I'm told that spirit left the United States and went half as far afield as, you can't guess it, Pakistan.
Yeah.
My God. Papa, I don't know. This is revolutionary. This is big.
Myself, I was shocked.
This
to
is
see
big.
It. I was
this
shocked
is big.
To see it.
So, but I'm going to allow you just listen to 1 minute each of the two videos, and the audios too will be on radio. So, studio, if you are ready, can we play this one? I don't understand anything of Yoruba, but I'm sure I would understand it. And the Pakistani guy,
yes.
Papa, what language is that one?
Punjabi, I'm sure.
Oh, Punjabi. Okay. Yeah. So, I want to listen to them. Can we have those ones now? Can we watch them? Are we set?
Lálẹ́ yìí, a ṣì ń gbé yẹ̀wò Ọlọ́run tí a ṣì mọ̀. A wà ní apá kejì ẹ̀kọ́ yìí, Ọlọ́run tí a ṣì mọ̀. Mo fẹ́ kí a ṣì ń pèlè wá sí ìwé Timothy kejì orí kẹta ẹsẹ̀ kẹẹ̀dógún. Ìwé Timothy kejì orí kẹta ẹsẹ̀ kẹẹ̀dógún. Àti pé láti ìgbà ọmọdé ni ìwọ ti mọ ìwé mímọ́, tí o lè sọ di ọlọgbọ́n sí ìgbàlà nípasẹ̀ ìgbàgbọ́ nínú Kristi Jésù. ati fi idi re mule wipe igbala o je igbagbo ninu Christi Jesu igbagbo ninu Christi Jesu lo nsalaye majemu lailai tabi igbagbo ninu Christi Jesu on lo ntan mole si majemu lailai je iwe mimo eleyi ti a pe ni Agios grammar iwe mimo iwe ti a ya soto tabi iwe mimo Paul wa nba Timothy soro o ni lati igba omo omo
आपको मुकाशिफात हासिल करने चाहिए जैसे ही आप यीशु को जानते हैं मजहब मर जाता है क्योंकि मजहब यीशु नहीं है और यीशु मजहब नहीं है इसीलिए तो मजहबी लीडर यीशु से लड़ते थे और जो मजहबी लीडर थे वो कौन थे फरीसी और फकी ऐसे मजहबी लीडर आज भी हैं वो दूर से देखते हैं और देखते ही उदास हो जाते हैं ये कि आप कौन हैं मसीह में ऐसे करते हैं ये मजहबी लीडर जब आप उन्हें कहते हैं कि मैं रास्तबाज हूं वो दूर से देखेंगे और देखते ही उदास हो जाएंगे आपने देखा मजहबी लीडर्स वो मुकाशिफा पूरे तौर पर कबूल ही नहीं करते जो यीशु मसीह ने
I don't know what to call this one. I always have words for every situation, Papa, but I have no words for this one.
And they never informed me.
Papa, so somebody sits in Uyo.
Yes.
He's doing something. Somebody sits. One person sits in the United States.
Yes.
Another sits in Pakistan.
Yes.
Of all places.
Yes.
And without any communication.
Yes.
So we don't even know whether somebody is doing it in Greece. Somebody is doing it in China.
We don't know. That's right.
I know somebody is doing it in Uyo.
And the guy in Pakistan has opened a YouTube channel. Where he's translating all my messages and loading them on the channel for his Pakistani people.
Lord have mercy.
I'm telling you. I just found that today.
I hope something like this is happening to you.
I hope
you know,
it is.
I can't wait to have something in Ibibio, you
yes.
know, so I can brag with
That's
it,
right.
you know.
That's right.
Okay. Papa, we slept last night. By the way, I'd like to congratulate those people. We need
yes.
to, the church will need to write a letter of commendation, a letter of thank you, a massive letter to both of them. And that letter should be hitting them anytime soon. I hope my producer has heard that.
Yeah.
Okay, Papa, last night we spent last night in Canada.
Yeah.
So we're beginning from Canada tonight. And the same man who is always there for us, Fabrice Kelvin, writes. He writes from Winnipeg and says, Papa, in Hebrews 10:32-35, was he talking to believers? It seems to me so, but the tension is followed in verses 38-39. In verse 36, what is the promise that is being talked about? It seems believers can string back, Papa. I feed on your meals daily and understand and agree 100% that the gospel of Christ, which you preach, I just lack understanding of this text. I would love if you explain it from verse to verse.
That's
verse 32-39, verse by verse, please. Hebrews 10.
All right, so in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 32, it was talking about the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great fight of afflictions. And Brother Paul was talking about, cast not away therefore. Now, so chapter 10 is talking about the children of Israel and all that they went through. The children of Israel, all that they went through. If you go back, you will find out that the writer of Hebrews was talking about the Old Testament. Because now you must understand the spirit of the book of Hebrews. That will help you a lot. The book of Hebrews is a book of contrast between what was in the Old Testament and what is in the New Testament. In chapter 1, he retires the prophets. Sundry times God spoke to the fathers by the prophets. Then in this last days, he speaks in his son. Chapter 2, he retires the angels. Which of the angels said at any time, you are my son? Chapter 3, he retires, you know, the Aaronic priesthood. And he says, Jesus is our high priest. So he went on retiring the old and establishing the new. Same thing here in chapter 10. He was talking about the children of Israel, those of them that, you know, didn't hold on, those of them that did not believe in what Christ has made available to them. If I look at the way he said it in that 32, where I started reading, call to remembrance the former days. First of all, he begins with, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So he begins to talk about the Old Testament people. In verse 38, he now says, cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For you have need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. 37. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now, the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Now, he's talking about the children of Israel who left, you know, from Egypt to Kadesh Barnea and to the promised land. Then he now says of you, but we are not of them who draw back unto perdition. but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So it was a contrast between those people that went to the promised land who did not believe, and we that have believed today who are not of those that draw back. That's all he was doing there.
Okay, Papa, still in Canada, we take an anonymous entry, then we cross over straight to the United States. Hello, man of God. I really appreciate what you're doing in this end time as you unveil the undiluted gospel. My question is, 10 days to marry, your faith has not produced result. What do you do if your faith has not produced expected result?
10 days to get married is a long time. Moreover, what do you mean by result? Because as far as I'm concerned, all you need to get married is the consent of the parents and the consent of your parents. And once your parents and her parents have agreed that two people can get married, the next thing you need is your pastor's office. You and your lady go to your pastor's office. Your father and her father comes to your pastor's office making two fathers, maybe with the mothers making four, you and the lady making six of you, and your pastor, seven of you, is all you need to do the marriage. What you're talking of result now is you're thinking of how to feed your whole city. You're thinking of how to wear a white gown and wear a suit and wear shoes and wear all those things. That's what you're calling result. And to me, those are not part what makes marriage. If you're very serious about getting married, you better go with your lady to your pastor's office, marry quickly. The money you will have wasted on reception, use it and start a small business for your wife. After 5 to 10 years of being married, and you people have made quite some good money and success, you can bring the whole of Nigeria to your house to come and celebrate your 10th year anniversary. That makes more sense.
Okay, Papa, from Canada, we're crossing over to the United States, where an American writes to us. Dear Papa, I'd like to thank you for your teachings. I'm writing from the United States. I have some questions regarding marriage. My husband is the one who introduced me to you, and I was attracted to him because of the knowledge he had when I first met him. I started to follow your preaching and it really opened my eyes. My husband and I left separately because of his work right now. So I'm listening to your message closely daily, but it's not there. It just seems my husband just listens to you here and there and now and again. And I started to feel like my knowledge from what you teach went above his own. Then I started to have some questions concerning our marriage. You said yesterday that masturbation is sin. My husband asked me to do it while we are away so that I can please him in a sexual relationship. He once mentioned that he is planning to have another wife because I'm not satisfying him sexually. Is it a sin if I do it for the purpose of pleasing my husband? And another thing he said was that his first priority in marriage is sexual relationship. I started to question it. He even brings up divorce because he's not satisfied with me in that area. Should sexual relationship, Papa, be the first priority in marriage between believers? I can't really agree. So what then should be the first priority? Thank you.
Well, the first priority in marriage should be companionship. God says it's not good for a man to be alone. I'll make a help meet for him. So companionship should be the bedrock on which marriage exists. Two are better than one, coming together to help each other to serve God and to help each other to build a godly home and to help each other to be a blessing. Those are the bedrocks for marriage. Sex is just an addition. Other things are all added to bring pleasure to that union. Sex is not the main thing, because if it is all about sex, then he doesn't need to marry. He can just go around sleeping around. He is married because he needs a companion to serve God with. However, sex is also important in marriage. So my advice to you and your husband, I have just heard your part. I need to hear his own part. I can't give a verdict based on one side of his story. So my advice, both of you may need to reach out to me again. You may need to convince him. Both of you, give me a call or send me a mail with your numbers and I will give you a call. And I will ask your husband questions. I will ask you questions. And we'll look at the word of God together and bring sound counsel. That's my take.
Papa, let's run from the United States to Africa. Let's land in Zambia. Greetings, Papa Damina and Mr. Bush. This is States Munchini from Zambia in Kabwe. Please, I want to say thank you, Papa, for your mentorship and for your response to my question the other day. My other question is from 1 Corinthians 14, 1 to 2. It says, when we speak in tongues, we speak a language not known unto men, for we speak mysteries. It is clear, then, that tongue speaking is a language of immortality. My question, Papa, is, will it be correct to say that when the day comes when we shall put off these mortal bodies, the only language that will eternally, entirely remain is tongues?
The Bible didn't teach us that, so we won't go beyond where the Bible stops.
Okay, so from there we come to Kenya. We move to Kenya from Zambia. And it says, dear sir, and this is Mukonga Singi writing, was Adam created to physically die, or he brought physical death upon himself by the fall? I heard you say Jesus would still have died even if Adam had not sinned. The Bible says he was of the earth. Does that mean subject to physical death?
Well, again, remember, Adam was not mortal, neither was he immortal. Just like Jesus was not mortal, neither was he immortal. It is a choice that determined Adam becoming mortality. That choice of rejecting God's plan for him. If he had accepted God's plan for him, then there would have been no mortality. So he was neither mortal nor immortal. It was when he rejected Christ that he now died spiritually, which now resulted into physical death.
Closer home, Ghana, and Janet is an Accra Papa. Please, in one of your teachings, you spoke about we as believers being able to determine how long we live here on earth. Please, Papa, explain further for me.
Well, again, I gave you scriptures. You know, God does not determine how long you live here. There are many factors that determine how long you live here. Your faith, your lifestyle, you know, a lot of things determine how long you live on earth. So again, it is not God. It is not God that determines whether you go to heaven or hell. If such things as important as that is not determined by God, what is living on earth? So that's the way, you know, to look at it. But if you get back to that message, you will get all the scriptures. Brother Paul says, I am in a strait between two, whether to go or to stay. Death come. For me to go, you will lose me. I will not be a blessing to you. But if I go, I will be with Christ. Okay, death go. Let me stay and be a blessing to the people for some time. And Paul stayed. He lived long as he wanted. Then finally he said, I have fought the good fight. I have kept my feet. I have finished my course. And henceforth is laid a crown. And even when he was still saying that, he was still writing books. He didn't still die. Until when he said, now I am ready to be offered. And if you observe, all the time people died in the Bible says, and he gave up the ghost. They didn't collect the ghost from him. He gave it up. He gave up the ghost. That means it was an operation of his will. So dying or living this earth is within the confines of your will. And your choices and lifestyle will play a major role in how long you live or how short you live on it.
Very shortly, it will be 7:30 to the minute in Uyo, Akwa Ibom State, Nigeria. Is the second part. And the 13 of 30 days of glory. Still 17 more days to go. We continue to thank God for that. Okay, still from Ghana. Lemmy. Good evening, Papa. I thank God for you and I congratulate you on giving yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ to use you to bless us. When I was young, about 14, 15 years, I came in contact with adult materials and started masturbating. One day, while still a young boy, I said, if I don't stop it, I should never be rich, thinking this would force me to stop this shameful act. I'm now 36 years old, Papa, and can't stop it. Though I've tried several times, including prayers. I'm now married with children, but still do this thing. I seriously want to stop and I need help urgently because I don't like the course my life is going. My question, Papa, do you think that after being saved, those words I spoke while young could still hold strong over my life? What would be your practical guidance on how to stop this tormenting heart and enjoy life as I should? Thank you. Lemmy in Ghana.
Well, my practical guidance is, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. My advice, get some people around you that are spiritual, that are matured in the things of God, and then let them become your accountability system. Let them know what you're struggling with. Let them know what you're going through. And then you and them will work out a plan of accountability where they are able to walk you through and help you through until you come to where you're no more obsessed, where you're no more struggling with that habit. And that's how to break any form of habit apart from, you know, masturbation. You've got to get an accountability system. People that will help you, people that will walk you through, people that will encourage you, people that will be there for you until you come out of it. That's the way to go. So get an accountability system. But there must be people that are spiritual, not people that will beat you over the head, not people that will condemn you. People that will help you to focus more on Christ, focus more on valuable things, and focus more on productive things. That way, within a short while, it will be a thing of the past. There's a woman who watched my TV broadcast in Abuja who said she was into lesbianism. And she has been an elder in a church, she told the name I wouldn't call here, for 20 years. And she has taken many girls in their church into lesbianism with her. But then she stumbled on my TV broadcast and began to watch. I didn't condemn her. I just kept talking Christ. and what he has done. She kept watching. She kept watching. Then she developed interest. Then she couldn't stay away from my teachings. After a while, her appetite for lesbianism started dying. She started feeling unclean every time she does those things with the ladies. And then she became sad. And then she started staying away. And that was it. She got over it. The ladies would be calling her. She'd be telling them she's busy. And after many months, she now reached out to me and said, look, you've set me free from this habit just by teaching the word of God. That's what the word of God does. If the word of God does not have the power to free you from habits, then it means what you're hearing is not the right word. The Bible tells us, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed thereunto according to your word. David said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against you. Brother Paul said, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. When the word of God fills you up, my brother, you will find out that overcoming bad habits will be very easy, because Jesus, you know, gives you the power to live above sin.
When Ghana, Papa, and I still have, I'm inundated, if you like, by too many entries from the other parts of Africa. But since Ghana is closer to Nigeria, let's dash down here. Uyo is our next port of call. And Mrs. Nsika, House Center, Godwina Bay Close, a warehousing estate district, Uyo, writes me a lengthy one. She's given about 8 questions. As she says, comes from one or that questions from some of those they invited over. Number one, Papa, native doctors and voodoo, how does their power work when you say the gods are dead?
Their power works over the people who don't know who they are, and their power works over people who are not saved. Yeah, they have powers, but those powers are nothing to be compared to what the believer has. In fact, what the believer has renders what they have non-effective.
Papa, the second question from that house fellowship, the house church, is a man is born Muslim, Papa, can certainly not be faulted for being born Muslim. When he dies, what happens to him?
He will have heard the gospel. The Muslims are catching the gospel. If you know how many people are following me in Saudi Arabia, how many people are following me right in the heart headquarters of Islam, Saudi Arabia, in Dubai, in Qatar,
in Iran,
Iraq, they are in their numbers. You cannot imagine. Look at Pakistan. So you can't just assume. It's assumption. The gospel is moving and the word of God is growing all over the world.
Number three, explain the term the price of death was paid to sin.
Because the wages of sin is death. So if the wages is from sin, who should the price be paid to? To death. God is not the kidnapper. It is sin that kidnapped man. So Jesus paid to sin what you owed sin to free you from the bondage of sin. I have a whole teaching on it. Who was the price of sin paid to? And I recommend that to you. Soteria season 6, who was the price of sin paid to? It will do a lot of work for you in your life.
Number four, all have sinned and come short. In our prayer, should we not declare we are sinners? That's confession.
No, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God in Romans 3:23 was actually written concerning the law. All have sinned is the law has condemned all under sin. And Jesus took care of the law and nail the law, put an end to the law. So your faith in Christ now makes you the righteousness of God. And if you are righteous, there's no sin to confess. So that's why we tell you that forgiveness of sin is not an answer to confession. Forgiveness of sin is a gift of grace. You don't even ask for it. God gave it to you. God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Moreover, remember, your confession is of zero value. It has no value in the things of the spirit because sin is a legal issue. That is why it took God becoming a man to die, to settle sin permanently. So that when you believe in Christ, you are free from sin and the demands of sin.
Number five, everyone does Holy Communion. Papa, why do you say it's not biblical?
Well, everyone doesn't do Holy Communion, so that is not correct. Some people do is what you should say. And I will encourage you tonight at 10 p.m., I have a full teaching on the entire concept of Holy Communion and Passover. It will be on my Facebook page, at Abel Damina, public figure. It will be on that page and it will be on YouTube, Abel Damina Ministries. Tonight, part one will be aired tonight and part two will be aired tomorrow night on Holy Communion and this whole concept. So all the people that have been asking us questions, I will recommend for you to be settled on that Facebook page. Whether you're listening on radio, just get some data. Tonight, 10 p.m., GMT plus one, it will be live. My teachings on the Holy Communion, extensive exegesis. Tonight is part one. Tomorrow night is part two.
Okay, I just need to quickly give you some addendum to what Papa has just said. I know that this program is broadcast as well on Comfort FM, it's on Excel FM and Inspiration FM. Please remember, no matter where you are on the surface of the earth, you can reach these stations as well. So it's not just on Facebook or TV. You can also hook up to the websites of these stations and listen live. So question number 6 from the House Church. Are we to obey the Ten Commandments, Papa?
Well, if you observe, Jesus didn't call them Ten Commandments. Jesus called them commandments. Commandments. Now, what Moses gave as the Ten Commandments, in the New Testament, Jesus summarized it to 2. One towards God and one towards your neighbor. The one towards God is the love of God shed abroad in your heart. Which once that love of God, which is Christ himself, is on your inside, the outflow of that Christ in you is love for the brethren. That's what it is.
Papa, 2 more. We're done with the house center. And these questions again were sent in by Mrs. Nsika. Number 7, why did Jesus use the derogatory word of food is for the dogs, a derogatory phrase, really, for the woman who asked for her daughter's healing?
Well, remember, Jesus was under the law, so he used figurative expressions that they could handle and could understand what he was really implying. Because actually, in the realm of the spirit, if you're not born again, you are a dog. Bible says, without are dogs. So it was a figure of speech telling the woman her state. And the woman, look at it. The woman said to Jesus, yes, Lord, I am a dog. But the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And Jesus said, wow, I've not seen faith. So her response to what Jesus said shows the level of faith she had in Jesus. She was too much in faith not to be offended. See that.
Okay, so question 8 and the last from Mrs. Sikak from the House Center right here in Uyo. It's in ours. The onlookers said that the tongues were in their languages. Please explain.
The tongues were not in their languages. That's Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. The Bible says the people heard them, not that they spoke. It was not they that spoke. It was the people that heard. Which means when they were speaking in tongues, God gave everybody that was physically there the gift of interpretation to be able to understand what they were saying. If you get into Corinthians, where the doctrine of tongues is, you will find out that tongues are not the languages of men. Tongues are to God, and no man understandeth him. Howbeit in the spirit, he speaketh mysteries. So for a man to understand tongues, it will mean that it is the gift of the interpretation of tongues given to that man. And it can be given to a believer, it can be given to an unbeliever. That's why it's a grace, it's a gift given to people who don't qualify.
Next, let's hear it for Florence Gopal. She writes, thank you, sir, for your great teachings. We honor and pray for your word to reach the ends of the earth with truth. We are thoroughly enjoying 30 Days of Glory 2020 this far. I have a question concerning end times. That's Mark 13:28, learn from the fig tree. Is this symbolic of Israel, as many have thought?
Yes, it was symbolic of Israel.
2, what is the abomination that causes dissolution in Mark 24:14 and Luke 21:20? Right now, churches are teaching that the end times are near because of what's happening in Israel.
Well, again, it was the collapse of Israel as a nation, which happened many years ago.
Florence concludes that she would appreciate clarity if you have materials already. May God truly bless and keep you and continue to cause his face to shine upon you despite persecution in Christ.
Amen. I have a whole series on, the Antichrist, Bible truth on the Antichrist. And there's a book we're getting out next week by the grace of God. The printers are working hard. The last days. You know, it's an eschatology material. When we advertise it, if you get a copy, it will be a great resource for you.
2 more anonymous materials, then we stroll out of Nigeria again and go into some part of Africa. Okay, this one says, greetings, sir. Oh, how delighted I am to write to you. I have always wondered why the prominent preachers in Nigeria are without the gospel, but another gospel, Galatians 1:6, not until I heard you preach on YouTube concerning this matter. I was glad because not all Nigerians are deluded. After all, I thank God for you and all those that are out there who are not known, but yet well known of the Lord, who are preaching the simplicity that is in Christ.
Praise God. Thank you.
Okay, quickly, another anonymous entry comes here and it says, I'm a little bit confused with the term Jesus is the Son of God. For my knowledge, I know Jesus is God. Why did he say the Father sent him, talking as if he was not him, God himself? Jesus is God made man, or a man made from the nature of God. I want to put a final full stop on this question. Who really is Jesus? God, the Son of God, a man made of God?
Jesus is God who became a man to save man. Jesus is God, pre-incarnate deity, who became the incarnate for the purpose of salvation.
To South Africa next, and author Sajeni writes from Mpumalanga, Nispoort, and he says, I need clarity, sir. As I heard you on the telecast the other day, you said Abraham was tested by himself. So who provided the lamb?
Abraham tested himself, and in the course of his test, he now saw the reality of his test. So it was a figurative communication. Again, the Old Testament is a figurative. Most of those things are figurative. A figure of speech, all right? Just like you will now say, where did the fish that swallowed Jonah come from? You know, you can ask that kind of question. It's figurative. It's a communication. So my advice, get my teaching on Soteria 6. I think it's part 1 or 2. Part 1 or 2, Soteria 6. That's where I did exegesis on how that it was Abraham who was testing himself to see how much he has understood of the gospel that was preached to him before of God in Galatians 3:8.
South Africa still, and this time Johannesburg, Polane writes, he has two questions. Papa, you taught us that according to the book of James, chapter 1, verse 14, God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempt any man. What does it mean in 1 Corinthians 10:9, when it says, neither let us not tempt Christ as some of them tempted?
The word tempt there means let's not ask Christ to do what is not within the confines of his doings. That's what it simply means. It's like test. It's like asking Christ to do what Christ doesn't do. It's like telling Christ to kill somebody, which he doesn't do.
Let's round off with Polane. Sorry, Papa.
Sure.
He says, Papa, you taught us that the Old Testament must be read in light of Christ, that we should not read the Old Testament in isolation as that would lead to error. The book of Esther, Papa, is used in many churches as a model to women. I've gone through the book, but could not find a character that emulates Christ or points us to Christ. Papa, can you summarize what are the lessons in light of Christ in the book of Esther?
Well, my advice, again, go back and read that book of Esther again, tonight and tomorrow. If you still don't find Christ after reading with all you have had in the last few days, send another email and on Monday I'll give you a very brief summary of the book of Esther.
Okay, to Zambia, out of South Africa now, I have two, three questions out there. And Kitwe is where we are. Victor Sibanda writes, greetings to the Power City House. Surely, great grace and peace from our Lord Jesus continues to abide with you for the work you're doing. Have been blessed so much with the gospel from you, Papa. Continue blessing us, Daddy, in our Lord Jesus Christ. My concern, one, with my mighty hand, he will let them go. Okay, should be with my mighty hand, I will let them go. Exodus 6:1. I'm the Lord, I appeared to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob as Almighty God. Exodus 6:2. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborns in Egypt. Exodus 12:29. Kindly, Papa, Dr. Abel Damina, I'm learning the truth of revelation that we kill, destroy, nor that God does not kill, destroy, nor does he do any evil, even as we have seen from Jesus Christ's true and full expression. Now, in this case, was it the same God who appeared to Moses who killed the firstborns?
In the Old Testament, when you see the word Lord and the Lord God and the Lord God, some of those Lords you see in the Old Testament were idols and some of them were judges. Some of them were idols. It was not exclusively used for God. So the Lord God will have to be read within the context and will have to be looked at in the light of Christ to know whether it was God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, or it was an idol or some evil spirits or some demons that took advantage of a situation and attributed it to God. So again, it has to be read in the light of Christ. So my advice is this. I did an extensive teaching on that covers most of those Lord God scriptures in the Old Testament. And it is the misunderstood God. Misunderstood God part 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Misunderstood God. If you get that and settle down and patiently follow the study, you will see all of those demystified.
Radio audience, plus 234-806-800-9939. I'll take your calls in another 3-4 minutes. I'm waiting for that, but let me go back to Skitwe, Zambia, where Victor Sibanda is. He continues, Papa, as he said, by my mighty hand, I will let the Israelites go, and the Israelites go, and that he is the same God who appeared to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. If yes, what made him do that? Then, if no, how can we convince people, much more those that are exposed to these scriptures?
By his mighty hand?
I'll let the Israelites go.
Okay, in the Old Testament, that's deliverance. That's the part God plays. God's part in every situation is to deliver. to save. That's why it's called Savior. So anywhere you see deliverance, it is God's intervention in a situation. Remember the Passover night. That Passover night, they now said, God said, put the blood mark. Then they now said that when the Lord passed over, if you don't have the blood mark on your doorpost, God will kill you. But it was not God that was killing. It was the destroyer. The only part God played was to protect people who put the blood on their doorpost. So in bringing Israel out of Egypt, it was God who delivered them from bondage, a type of salvation from the oppression of sin. Again, the Old Testament was communicated in types and shadows. So the salvation there was the part God played.
Quickly, let's round off with this entry by Victor Sibanda in Zambia. I really need help, Papa, on how to pray in the Holy Ghost. I really desire to pray in tongues. Should I pray specially, wait, or what can I do? Please help me, Papa. This would greatly bring great impact on my spiritual life.
If you send us an email again with your phone number and with this request, we will call you, we will share with you and take you through and help you to yield to the utterance of the Holy Spirit that you already have inside you, but you don't know.
Cassandra Boya is in Mufulira, Zambia, and says, Papa, my question is about the time Jesus was with his disciples. Were they justified or not?
When Jesus was his disciples?
With disciples.
Justified in what sense?
Well, he didn't explain.
Well, justification is by faith. So before Jesus died, they just had righteousness attributed to them because they believed in Jesus. But the gift of righteousness was given when Jesus rose from the dead. So in a sense, yes, they were given the right. They were given a right or a promissory note. Just like Abraham was called righteous, all right, because he believed. So faith in Christ gave them rights. But when Jesus rose from the dead, he now made them or made us righteous.
Okay, Papa, I need to come back to Nigeria, but I need to make two quick stops. First to Italy, and then in quick succession to South Korea, of all places. Casey Cole writes from Italy. Daddy, thank you so much for the opportunity given to us to ask questions. This is really, really huge. Sir, I need a little explanation on 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 3 and 4. Daddy, who is that man of sin, the son of perdition, that verse 4 says, will sit in the temple of God, claiming that he himself is God? Sir, which of the temples would he sit on? Thank you, sir. You are a blessing to this generation.
Again, my book on the last days will demystify all of that. But remember, if you read the previous chapter, the Bible is reading contextually. Read the previous chapter. He talked about people that obey not the gospel. Not one person. People that obey not the gospel. So where he said man of sin, he was not talking to man. It's actually men of sin. There is a syntax issue with that translation that needs to be rearranged. So my advice is, if you get my book on the last days, I did exegesis on that entire, portion of Thessalonians.
Okay, to South Korea quickly from Italy. This is going to be a quick flight. Says, good evening, Papa. My name is Pastor Everest Chuku. I'm in South Korea. Papa, I've been following your teachings for 6 years now. In fact, your teachings have brought clear revelation of Jesus to me. I'm learning every day through your teachings. I have joy, peace, and boldness of salvation in my heart. May our Father continue to strengthen you and deliver you from religious preachers. I thank God for bringing reformation in the body of Christ.
Amen. Amen. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, quickly, we can now fly back to Nigeria, and I want us to come to you via Kaduna State. Says, Papa, this is Babas writing. I need your prayers. I have serious crisis in my marriage. I lost my job and my wife has left me with the kids. Papa, we take that prayer for him. First, though, our first caller tonight. Hello. Okay, it's not there. So, Papa, can we just quickly pray for Babas? Okay, the caller is back on the line. Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us. Anywhere you're calling from. Quickly. Go ahead.
I'm calling from Port Harcourt.
Your name?
Good evening.
Good evening. Your name?
Hello.
Evening.
My name is Yomuna, calling from Port Harcourt.
Go ahead.
Yes. I want to appreciate Papa for the good work he's doing. I want to appreciate Papa for the good work, and I want to thank God for his life. We are blessed. I and my family. God bless you, Papa.
Bless you.
Okay. We take another caller, but Babas, we need to pray for Babas. Okay. They won't allow us to pray for Babas. Okay, another caller. Hello. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're calling from? I didn't hear that.
Evening, where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Uyo.
Okay, Uyo, calling from Uyo. Go ahead.
Yeah, Papa, my question is number one. Where is the man?
Where is what?
Where is the man?
The man Jesus seated at the right hand of majesty on high. He is seated at the right hand of majesty on high. He is in heaven, the immaterial.
Okay, thank you. Papa, let's just quickly pray for Babas, whose wife has left him because of some serious crisis.
My goodness. Father, we pray for Babas that he has direction. He is not confused. We speak peace to your mind. Peace to your mind. Receive direction. Know exactly what to do. Take the right steps. And in the name of Jesus, receive supernatural help. Supernatural help. Supernatural help in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for answered prayer. And we thank you for the miracle that turned Baba's life around. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. From Kaduna to Uyo, James Atom has two questions. James has two questions. I'll quickly take that and says, Papa, thank you for your responses to the questions. I'm a junior pastor in my church, and I have approached my immediate senior pastor on the issue of mixture, but I've been seen as a rebel. What should I do? Before we field his question, let's dash to this caller. Hello. Yeah, thank you for joining us. Your name, where you're calling from? 1 minute.
Hello, how are you?
Evening.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us. Your name, where you're calling from?
Yeah, I'm Pastor Austin in UK.
Okay.
So,
praise God.
And all our ministers, especially of the but I cannot believe the kind of humility you have done when all the drama pastors have gone on that ground. But the Lord is I haven't seen you yet because
thank you, Pastor Austin. Bless you. Bless you again. Nice to hear from you.
Okay. Can we, I don't know if you can have time, a little window for one more call. We'll take that. But Papa, James Atom in Uyo has a problem with mixture.
Yes.
Went and wanted to show that he knows and he was...
he's under persecution.
That. Okay, I hear that the last caller is here. The last caller for the night. Hi. Thank you for joining us. Your name, where are you calling from?
Good evening, Papa.
Evening. Bless you.
My name is Ikoye Nemana. Calling from number 8 at Tampa, we are in one district.
Okay.
Papa, we thank you in this house, this seat of Mr. Matthew. We are grateful to have you, Papa.
Thank you.
Because, like, we are discussing, Papa, as we now look at the precious teaching that you were teaching maybe years ago. And we are very, very proud that you have accepted and yielded yourself to this message of Christ. That Christ has used to open our eyes to you for our generation. And so I'm also trying to reason, if you didn't heal yourself, what would have become of us? Especially those that look upon you. Thank you, Papa, for the clarity of the word. And we pray God to deliver you from the hands of unreasonable men and also from the religious leaders. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, that's our last caller for the night, and I think we should go back to James Atom. So what does he do?
James, my advice. Well, you have already put yourself out.
Sure.
So now there's no going back.
Back, okay.
Okay, so what you will do is prayerfully find a way to withdraw gradually from the church so that the fire is not much on you while you seek the Lord in prayer to know what next to do with your life. It's okay. Very important.
Okay, Papa, you know, we spent a couple of nights out. The other day was in some country in Africa, and yesterday was in Canada. Today we must sleep in Uyo.
Okay.
And so I'm trying to come back home more and more. So still from James Atom, Here in New York, Papa, what's the difference between Ten Commandments and the law of Moses? Is Ten Commandments part of Moses' laws?
No, the Ten Commandments are different from the law of Moses. The Ten Commandments, if you observe, there's no curse in them. But the law of Moses has curses. Moreover, the Ten Commandments were in the Ark of the Covenant. But Moses took his laws and attached them by the Ark, not in the Ark. So the law of Moses is Moses' way of interpreting the Ten Commandments in 612 ways to the children of Israel. And if you observe, the law of Moses has curses and all of that. But the commandments don't have any. And if you observe, Jesus didn't call them Ten Commandments. He called them commandments. The apostles didn't call them Ten Commandments. They called them commandments. So, like I always teach, I will encourage you to get my teachings that covers that. It's called the two kinds of righteousness. Two kinds of righteousness. It will help you with that.
Papa, we need to go. Two more questions should take us to the top of the hour. Ubongabasi Jumbo is still in New York. Says, good evening, Papa. I must say God is using you to open many eyes. My question is, if water baptism is of the Old Testament, as you said, why did Jesus undergo baptism through John the Baptist?
Because the purpose for the baptism was to identify Jesus. That's why Jesus said he has to fulfill righteousness. The righteousness there is in helping John the Baptist discover who he was so that John the Baptist can introduce him. That was the whole mission. So the whole mission was for Jesus to be identified and introduced. And I will encourage you, grab your Bible so that it won't be that I said. Grab your Bible, read the book of John chapter 1 from verse 29 to the end of that chapter. Then read Ephesians chapter 4 verse 5. That should clarify you.
Papa, I'm afraid because of time and the lack of it, I'm just wondering what I can squeeze in this one. It says, good evening, Papa. Thank you for your labor of love. My name is Victoria. I'm writing from Uyo. Papa, I need your advice in my relationship. We love each other so much and he's been trying for me. We are planning to get married by the grace of God this year. But recently he told me that he's going to get married to a second wife in future. I asked him why. He said what he likes. But Papa, please advise me. Should I go on with the relationship? Because, you know, when we started with him, we didn't have money, but now he has money. He's thinking nonsense.
That's so he doesn't want you again. If he doesn't want you again, leave him alone. Because if you push yourself on him, you will become the housemate.
Mm.
So if he doesn't want you again, leave him alone, pray, and just serve God and focus on God. You know, focus. I'm advising you sincerely. Focus on God. When your heart is stayed on God and your heart is stayed on Christ, all other things will be taken care of.
Okay.
I know you will have pain and heartbreak, but Jesus is the healer. You know, just let it go and let the Lord heal and fix you today.
Papa, we must go. Same time says so. I'd like to thank 30 Days of Glory Studio crew. They have been wonderful. They are fantastic cameramen, the directors, everyone. My producer, Pastor I.G. Aquarian, the rest, Pastor Praise Thompson, Pastor Dr. Godison, Pastor Edimo Kohn, that's the deep, and of course, my friend, Mr. Exto, and Engineer Kubi and Baba, who met sure I got here. On your behalf, this is Michael Bush. Signing off and looking forward to another day tomorrow. Papa is here with short benediction.
Oh, my goodness. It's going to be explosive. Mr. Bush, it's happening again. I'm enjoying being with you here every
Thank
day.
You, Papa.
Now, listen, tomorrow is going to be explosive. I'm teaching 8 a.m., you know, on Facebook, on Kingdom Life Network TV, and on all the various platforms. But the 11 o'clock is going to be the service that will be live on Radio Comfort FM, and we'll be live till about 1 o'clock. Then at 1 o'clock, we will have another broadcast on XLFM till 3 o'clock tomorrow. It's exciting. You don't want to miss the broadcast right now on Inspiration by 8 to 9 p.m. tonight. But I'm excited. And remember to be on Facebook tonight at 10 p.m. on my page. My page is Abel Damina. It's public figure and is verified. Any page that is not verified is not mine. Catch me, beat me there at 10 o'clock tonight as we look at discerning the lost body part 1 and part 2. We love you guys. Enjoy the rest of your day and we'll connect with you tomorrow. Until then, be blessed.
Good night from Uyo, Nigeria.
Amen.
Jesus is the exclusive custodian. Jesus is the sole carrier. Jesus is the perfect imprint, the pleroma, the corporate headquarters of the Godhead. Jesus is the executive carrier of the Father. So if you don't know Jesus, you don't know the Father. You can never know the Father outside of Christ.
Church in the air and church online. Join Drs. Abel and Rachel Damian. as he brings you sound Bible study through the month of July at 30 Days of Glory 2020, exegetically examining the fundamentals of the Christian faith, salvation in Christ. Date from 5th of July to 2nd of August 2020. Time 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. from Mondays to Saturdays, 8 a.m. and 11 a.m. on Sundays. Book up live on our Facebook and YouTube page, and also live on Kingdom Life Network TV, on My TV, or Strong Decoder, and live on Comfort FM Oyo by 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Mondays to Saturdays, and 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. every Sunday. Also listen to a rebroadcast of the services daily on XLFM 106.9 Oyo from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. daily, and live on Inspiration FM 105.9. 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. daily. Be a part of this program. Don't miss it.